one who says.
Honestly, my friend. From
okay,
let's try that. I think now we've done, finished most of the stuff we needed to do about the Fourier transforms. And we can do a little application now. So there's this little section on the central limit theorem that I want to spend, I guess, a fair bit more today. So, who here has done some probability or sort of mathematical statistics? Or some people, nearly everyone has done some. Okay. If I'm boring you at the beginning, tell me to hurry up. Okay, so what do we want to say? So, to say we have some real value random variable x. So we say it has probability density function. See, cumulative. This one is the. This one is the. Sorry. Absolutely. Yes, I'm just really the wrong thing here. Thank you. Here I wanted to write this. Great. Okay. That's the. This is the density of probability. It's the probability up to some level. Is the integral of this density function to minus infinity. Okay. And so then two random variables, x and y, are independent. A good way of saying this is just that if you look at the probability that x is a, same time y is in subset b, that's just the probability that x is in a times the probability of y is in b. Okay. So what we want to just start with is just thinking about how this looks in terms of PDFs. So what we'd like to look at is this, the probability that the sum of two independent random variables is less than r. Okay. And so the way that we're going to compute that is as follows. What we'd like to do is think about the probability density function for x and y jointly. So here, probability that x is less than t and y is less than s, if we're assuming x and y are independent, is just this is just probability that x is less than t times the probability that y is less than s, and so then the generally, then, if values are now given by integrals of some little f, x has PDF f, y has PDF g, then what I'm going to say is that the probability pair x x, y is in subset A, so it's in A, is some subset of R2. This is just a new integral over A on f of x. Okay, sorry. So now we can get back to here. Maybe I should have postponed saying that for a little while. So then the probability that x plus y is less than or equal to r is exactly the same thing. Saying that x plus y is less than r is just saying that that the pair x comma y is down in that region there, where this is the line x plus y equals r. So we can do this just as an integral of the products of the probability density functions. This is an integral. Let's do the integral over x first. So here, if we're doing the x coordinate first, well, this region, sorry, if we're doing the x coordinate first, we have to, every possible x coordinate is taken into account, so being equal from minus infinity to infinity. And once you've fixed x and you're doing y, where do you have to go? You have to go from y equals minus infinity to r minus x. And then just this f of x, g of y. Right. So now we can ask, what is the PDF for x plus y? And we do this just by differentiating. Don't drink and drive, and be careful when you move derivatives other than integrals. Let's just hope that it works here. We can just move the derivative inside the outermost integral, and then just use the fundamental theorem of calculus here, because the integrand here doesn't depend on the parameter r at all. It's just the upper limit there, and so this just becomes the integral from negative infinity to infinity of f of x, but we're going to take this guy and evaluate it at the point we're integrating up to, so it's g of r minus x dx, and that's just exactly the convolution of the two functions. Okay, great. So what did we learn then? If you've got two independent random variables, then the PDF of their sum is just the convolution of the PDFs of the two individual random variables. Awesome. Okay. So, let's just see a few easy consequences of that. Basically, running the same argument over a few times, if you've got a sum of random variables, and let's assume these are independent and identically distributed. Does everyone know the standard abbreviation for independent and identically distributed? IID, unsurprisingly, yep. Great. This is just the convolution power of f. Oh, sorry. D by dt of that. So the PDF of that sum is the convolution, the nth convolution power of the PDF. Involving the function itself a bunch of times. And what else? I guess the last thing we want to know is the PDF for the average of some of the IID variables. And this one is a little bit bulkier. So here, do people see, I mean, maybe it's a little bit surprising that there's a water-draining argument as well here. Should we see why that happens? I think it's pretty simple. I mean, I think you should just do, it's the probability that if you've got some
some random variable and you want to multiply it by a constant alpha. What do you do? Well, you can just compute this as well. Let's just rearrange that. That's just the probability that x is at most t over alpha. And then you compute this as the probability density function for the original x of s gs. And then just do a change of variables. Let's say s prime equals s over alpha. And what you get now, you get the integral from negative infinity up to t. F of s changes to f of alpha s prime. And similarly, ds picks up a factor of alpha ds prime. Okay? And now we can easily differentiate with respect to t and see that we picked up. You know, we scale the variable by both inside the argument and outside. That's why there's the one over there and the one over there. Okay. So where does that get us? Okay. So the goal now is to prove a version of the central limit theorem, which is meant to be saying that if you take any probability distribution and you look at this quantity, that average here, then the probability density function, this guy we see over here, should be converging to a Gaussian. That is, if you take the you take the same underlying distribution, you take the average of lots of copies of it, the PDF should converge to a Gaussian. We have to be a little bit careful because what we actually want to see happening is that depending on the number of measurements we take here in average, we're going to see a Gaussian of some different width. And as we take more measurements, we expect to see narrow and narrow Gaussians. So it's a little bit hard to say, we don't immediately want to say this thing converges to something, because as n changes, the thing it's sort of meant to be getting closer to, so we need to do a little bit of a fiddle first before we can actually say what it is that's converging. So the idea is that 1 over n f convolution power n t over n comes like the Gaussian. But with width, so you know, width is the same thing as variance, so the variance here. I mean, just the integral, the second moment of the PDF, this guy here, depending on n. So we do a little bit of a normalization class first. So let's say, suppose the variance of some function f is sigma. So variance is just defined by this formula. Let's just write a few little things here. Okay. First of all, some easy facts. If you take a function and multiply by a scalar, obviously that scalar just pops right out the front. It's a times the variance of f. And if you look at the variance of the function that sends t to...
It's x squared. It's x squared.
No, it's not x. So let's be careful here. So let's so this then just means the integral negative infinity to infinity of x squared a f x dx. A is just some constant that comes out front. And that's a term to the variance. This is the one that's slightly trickier. So here is where we're taking a function and rescaling the argument by some constant b. Okay? And so here we're going to get integral from negative infinity to infinity, x squared, f of bt, dt, change the variables midway through integral, bx dx. And now something a little bit more complicated happens. The claim is that this is going to be b to the minus 3 times the variance of f. basically, you can see why this happens. We need to do some change of variables to change this bx back to the integration variable y, but that will give us a factor of inverse b twice here and another factor of inverse b there.
And then the final one is the interesting one, claims that the variance of a convolution product is just n times the variance of what we start with. And that one is maybe not so obvious. So, I mean, if you sort of literally do this, really it looks insane. You've got some n minus one fold iterated integral in here, and we've got to do this crazy thing with n different integral symbols to do this. So what's the trick?
Induction.
What's that?
Do it by induction.
Do it by induction. Okay, yeah, that would definitely get us down to an easier case of even by induction, what exactly, it's not exactly clear to me what you would do.
Clarity.
Yeah, but there's a nicer trick than induction, so
can we use the Fourier transform?
Yeah, so we can use the Fourier transform. So the point is that this guy here is the integral from negative infinity to infinity of x squared nth convolution product of f and x, okay, which we can rewrite as the integral from negative infinity to infinity of e to the, you guys are going to have to remember, help me remember, there's a plus or minus sign here. Doesn't really matter because there's a zero there. I just put in a very boring explanation for that. But that then is just saying that this is the Fourier transform of x squared f convolution power n evaluated at xi equals 0. Okay? And so now we can pull out the usual tricks. Multiplication by a polynomial inside the Fourier transform is the same as differentiation outside. Someone can. Some signs, hopefully, if I get signs wrong. And now what do? We use the fact that Fourier transform takes convolution to multiplication and vice versa. So this is the second derivative of f of the Fourier transform, just normal power, it's multiplying it out. Oh, sorry, I should keep writing at zero. Now what do we need to do? Yeah, just do the differentiation because we're good at differentiating powers of things. So this is, what do we get? We just get, we're just taking the nth power of some function, so we get, should we do one derivative at a time to keep life easy? Let's keep one derivative out the front for a moment, and just put one different derivative inside, and we get n times d of f at zero. There, and then just f of f to the n minus 1.
Shouldn't we have that at 0 all the way up?
Well, yeah, you can choose whatever.
Okay.
Now, why does that help us?
Every cosine and subtract off the square of the expected value from every
let's get that out of the way here. Let's assume from now on that we have mean zero. All our probability distributions will just have mean zero, so that problem goes away. Yeah. You're right, that's a good point. That's not the definition of variance. Yeah. So is this actually going to... I didn't think about this one beforehand. I have a feeling we're going off down the wrong track here. I mean, something good has happened, an N has come out the front, but it's a little bit unclear to me how the rest of this is going to work.
If we do it by induction, it'd be much easier.
Okay, great. Okay, tell us the proof by induction.
Yep, I mean, using pretty much exactly the same argument as that probability example, we can show that the variance of N's convolution power of F is equivalent of the variance of the sum of N independent random variables.
You just want to show the
density function F.
You just want to do it like this.
Look at that. Actually, the convolution of F and G are exactly the probability that X plus Y equals to R, right?
Well,
if that thing is continuous, which is most of the case. So the nth order convolution is equivalent of the sum of n independent random variables with the same density function f. Yes, I think.
Okay, let's postpone this one. Okay. Did not think very hard about that. Let's do it. Okay. If anyone is feeling bored, they can do this exercise right now and get back to us at the end of the hour. How to do that. Okay, so what do we want to do? So the point of doing all of these things, working out how variances of things change, was just to work out a version of this that has constant variance depending on n. So what I want to do is take this guy. That's just meant to be an easy consequence of looking at those facts there. As you take the nth tensor power, the variance is going up by the nth convolution power, sorry, the variance is going up by a factor of n. This brings it down, this brings it up by another factor of n, and that brings it down by a factor of n to the negative 3/2. Okay. So what we're going to do is show that these functions gn converge in some sense you specified in just a moment to the following lovely Gaussian sum of this. So what does weakly mean here? This is something that we'll come back to much later in the course, and we'll see this as a sort of special case of a topology that exists that we'll learn about when we study Banach spaces. But for now, we'll just say exactly what we mean by it. We just mean for any k continuous and vanishing at infinity, i.e., it goes to zero in both directions, the integral of gn of x, k of x, dx over the whole real line converges as n goes to infinity to the integral of that guy. Just k of x equals. Okay? So at least by now we've got to the statement of the theorem. So the trick is to use Fourier transform. So this guy here is easy to compute the Fourier transform of, because we know how Fourier transform interacts with all the different things that we're doing here. And the claim is it's just the Fourier transform of one copy of itself at xi. When you divide by square root n, or you take the nth power. I mean, you can just take on faith that the constants are right, but the nth power there, of course, is the nth convolution power. Okay. So let's suppose, and this is something that we haven't proved yet, but we're going to need to come back and use that, and show rather, and show that, let's suppose that f hat is C2. Okay? So what do we know then about the derivatives and the second derivatives of f hat? Well, let's just take d by d xi at xi equals 0 of f hat. So that's the same as, I forget how we define our capital D operator, is it minus I or I, plus or minus, who cares, it's not going to matter at the moment, D, F hat at 0, we know we can move the D inside, some constant times the integral of e to the 0 x, f of x dx, which is 0 because we assume that our function, our probability distribution had been 0. Okay. And then similarly, d by d xi squared at xi equals 0 of f hat. Now, this pesky minus sign doesn't bother us because it's 2 of it. So we just have minus d squared at 0, this is minus e to the 0 x squared f of x dx, and that's exactly minus the variance. Okay. So basically the idea here is that if you have some function that has finite variance, assuming that we were really allowed to do these steps here, then it's C2, and the second derivative, well, the first derivative is 0, and the second derivative is minus C. But just, we'll come back to this to show f hat really is C2. Sorry, just emphasizing that we've cheated at this point and assumed that it was C2. If it is C2, then probably what that second derivative of 0 is. Do you think it's really quite in this room today compared to other days, or the walls are pushing? Just okay. So now, what can we say? Well, we've got some C2 function and we know its derivatives. And so we can say then that f hat at xi, well, I guess we didn't, there was maybe one more little calculation we've done here. What's f hat itself at 0? Again, just writing out the definition of the Fourier transform, we can just write that like that. And that's 1, because we're working with the probability distribution, the total probability distribution. Okay. And so this tells us that we can think about this guy via its Taylor series. We can write this as 1 plus 0 times xi for the first derivative minus sigma over 2 times the second derivative, and then we have to think about controlling the error term. So So let's first of all use Bayan this way, and it's plus a hero term with little o of exact squared. So which means, so let's now say what it means. For every epsilon, there's a delta. So as long as xi is really close, then the error between f hat and xi and 1 minus sigma over 2 xi squared is at most epsilon times xi squared. Okay. And this is basically enough, just a way of saying that close to here, we really can see that it behaves very close to the parabola that this is. Okay, so what do we do with that? Well, let's just write it out to make life a little bit easier here. We can write this as 1 minus sigma over 2 plus epsilon xi squared is less than f hat xi is less than 1 minus sigma over 2 minus epsilon xi squared. Just writing out, replacing remembering the absolute value in the inequality. And so then we can get that 1 minus, you can just take all this and raise it all to the nth power. Because remember, it's this thing that we're after, and now we're going to deal with this square root in here, so we're just substituting in everywhere here, we replace xi with xi over square root in. And we can write this as gn hat xi. Now, where is this true? Well, let's just be careful. This inequality was true as long as xi was less than delta, but we've just rescaled the variables, so we have to be a little bit careful. This holds as long as xi over square root n is less than delta. But sort of besides that condition, it holds for every n, because we introduced the n sort of arbitrarily later on, we just raised everything to the nth power. And so notice that if you fix a value of xi, this is eventually true. Okay, you make n big enough. So that's a large enough here. What do we do with that? Well, at this point you can just take the limits as n goes to infinity, and for any value of xi, those things are converging. That's just, hopefully, that's some basic thing from even the definition of the exponential function. I'm not sure which definition of the exponential function you guys would have used way back in 1115 or whatever, but it's essentially sort of in terms of limits of 1 plus x to the n is appropriately normalized. So, taking n to infinity, what do we get? We get e to the minus sigma over 2 plus epsilon xi squared is the limit as n goes to infinity, gn hat xi, and that's less than the exponential we go to the other side. Okay. What do you do at the end? Well, this was true for every epsilon. And the delta no longer appears anywhere in there, so we can just take epsilon to zero now. We just see that we actually calculate exactly the pointwise limits of these functions. So are we done? I've erased what the final statement was meant to be. What was the final statement? Was something about we wanted weak conversions of this whole function to this guy, and we're not there yet. So pointwise convergence does not imply the weak convergence we're claiming. They have a bit more work to do. So we still need to show we need this crazy business here. Oh, sorry, this sentence, I mean, was a little bit silly. I mean, maybe let me say something a little different. The point is that what we've done here is the pointwise limits of the Fourier transform, okay? And it's the function gn itself that we're interested in. So I was just saying something silly. But what we need to understand is how to get from this over to it's weak convergence of the inverse Fourier transform. So, right, again, this is the thing we're looking for. Okay. So, what can we say here? So, the first claim is that since this mess here is uniformly bounded in the L1 norm, so how do we know that it's uniformly bounded in the L1 norm? Well, this guy's certainly easy, and that's just some constant term there. And then when we know that these G and X's are uniformly bounded. Well, we can just write the integral. Maybe let's not worry about signs. Does this work? This is just the evaluation of the Fourier transform at xi equals zero. And we know that if you substitute in xi equals zero, this is some convergent sequence. So in particular, that sequence of numbers is a bounded sequence because it's convergent from one to one. Okay, so since that, it suffices to check this on a subspace curly S, this may be foreshadowing a little bit, on a subspace curly S, which is super. Remember, we're meant to. We're meant to check this for every k that's continuous and vanishing at infinity. And I'm claiming that you can just get away with checking on some space that's dense in there. And that's just meant to be a really easy argument. The limit of that stuff okay, so let's give this an A. Let's call that all H. So let's say it this way. So if we've got two different K's here that are very close together in supremum norm, then we can compute the limit as n goes to infinity of let's take the absolute value of this integral, so hn of x, k of x, dx, and then dx in absolute value. And now, of course, this thing here, you can use the triangle inequality to look at this term separately and that term separately. And then here, you can just pull out the supernorm of these guys. So when we, it's easier if I put the signs the other way around. So it's these terms go together, and there's that term there. So these first two terms are just bounded by the supernorm of k minus k prime times the L1 norm of Hn plus this quantity here, the limit as n goes to infinity of Hnx, k prime of x, And so if we're assuming that if we've already checked this on some dense subspace, k prime is now dense subspace, that's saying this limit is zero, and then this quantity is arbitrarily small, we've picked up k prime in the subspace over the first few months. Okay? So that's the explanation of why it's enough to check on some dense subspace. Now, the Schwarz functions. Schwarz functions are supernorm dense in continuous functions vanishing at infinity. And I'm not going to bother doing that, but it's pretty easy. Okay, I think it's in the notes. It is in the notes. Okay. So now, how do we do this? Well, we're almost there now. Parseval's formula. So this is something pretty easy. We know that the Fourier transform preserves norms, an L2 norm. And a pretty easy consequence of this is that it preserves inner products. We agree to use except there are maybe factors of 2 pi floating around here, we need to remove some 2 pi's. We should have some 2 pi's in here. Because the Fourier transform doesn't actually preserve this, it only preserves it up to a factor of 1 over 2 pi to the 2. Yeah, sorry. just write up to factor z through I. You guys can get straight when you need to. So why is this? I mean, if you've got some linear operator that preserves norms going between normal spaces, why does it preserve inner products? Yeah, so yeah, the point is that you can write inner products. How is it? You can write it as there's a formula here if you ever wanted, but basically you look at all the different linear combinations of if you expand everything out on the right hand side here, then various cross terms are all going to magically cancel, various leading order terms will cancel with these guys, and you can just get a new product. So the point is that if you've got some operator that preserves all norms, it necessarily preserves new products. This is a pretty neat idea. So that's okay. And so that gives us Parseval's formula. So we know the Fourier transform is actually preserving inner products as well. Okay, so where are we? We're trying to just compute this for k shorts. So what we have is this: that we take the limit as n goes to infinity, this integral gnx kx dx, and then the nodes seem to have the right factor of 2 pi, so we'll put in the factor of 2 pi that we left out there. The product of gn hat of xi k hat of xi kx. Okay, and so here, and we're taking advantage of the fact that we're assuming that k is Schwarz, so that we can even do this. This makes sense. K hat is still Schwarz. And so it's in L1. And the claim is that GN hat of xi. Remember, we proved that this was a function that converged pointwise, and we also want to claim that it's bounded. So why is that? This was all, it was only inside these limits that we had those bounds. So we do need some other. So, okay, so the goal here, so let's work out a moment what exactly we need there. The goal is to set things up so that we can use the dominating convergence theorem and bring the limit inside.
Sufficiently large, by the magnitude of delta,
So to, at each individual side, we've got this convergence. So from large enough n, this is close to this, this is definitely less than or equal to 1. So these guys will certainly be less than 1.5. And I think what's in the notes is actually wrong. Say that it's Gn psi is bounded, but of course there's going to be a hat there. It really is the Fourier transform we care about at this point. Okay, so the point is, yeah, so we can control all this by just some constant times the L1 function. This guy's converging pointwise, so we can use the domain of convergence theorem and bring that inside. That then gives us, we can now use our formula, that's just e to the minus sigma over 2 xi squared and hat of xi xi. And what do we do with that? Well, that's exactly what we're about. That's this guy here, except that I've clearly screwed up because this has both a sigma and an s in it. Surely we did the same thing in both places. Not sure where that came from. So there's still one more step. What's the step we still need to do? Let me try and leave that up. We're aiming to show that this integral of gn times kx is converging to this integral of this guy times this. So we just need to use Parseval again to go backwards. Okay? This is again by Parseval. And so this is now going to be the integral of the inverse Fourier transform of this guy times the inverse Fourier transform of that, which is of course just k of x dx. And then I think that is exactly this. We have to know that this is a Gaussian, so we have to remember that formula for the Fourier transforms of a Gaussian. You get a 1 over 2 pi just from the inverse Fourier transform, and then you get a 1 over sigma e to the negative x squared over 2 sigma. If you remember, there was this pattern that like the invariance of the Gaussian would turn into 1 over invariance when you Fourier transform. K of x, yes. And that was the random side. Okay, so that's a version of the simple limit theorem. Maybe, I don't know, possibly if you guys have seen versions of the simple limit theorem before, possibly this one was proved more carefully than previously you've seen it. Oh, geez, we're out of time. Okay, so there are two things that I meant to say. Y is f hat in C2, and the answer is essentially this thing that's explained in the notes and that I didn't get to today, called Riemann-Lebesgue. I would say Facebook app. I mean, basically, it tells you finite invariance implies Fourier transforms in C2. Well, that's a cool thing. And just a quick point, this is also in the notes and a bit further discussion, that if you take this guy, thinking of this as a probability density function, you can calculate, if you're good at contour integrals, you guys have all taken complex analysis and know that complex analysis is one of the really important courses that all undergraduates learn in mathematics should take. Okay. So by doing contour integration, you can actually do the Fourier transform here analytically, which is an extremely unusual thing, and see that it's this. And so then the PDF of the average of two copies of this random variable. Has Fourier transform we're meant to take the hat and we're meant to square it and look at it at xi over 2. And now if you just plug this into the formula, that's exactly, so we plug in xi over 2, but then we square it, and that's exactly back to this guy again. Okay? So, and so generally, so the PDF itself, so this is a nice example where the PDF of some average of copies of this variable with the same distribution is certainly not converting to a Gaussian, okay? Because when we just do one step, you can see that the PDF just comes back to exactly what's at the beginning. The same argument shows this happens no matter how many times you take averages. You can pretty easily check this is a function that doesn't have finite variance. Integral of t squared over 1 over t squared doesn't converge. It's got infinite variance. And this is a Cauchy distribution. And it's an example of what's called a stable distribution. Essentially, stable means exactly this. Like when you take the average of several copies of the variable with itself, you get basically the same PDF up to some shifts and scales and so on. And people have classified exactly what the stable distributions look like. And there are better versions of the central limit theorem that talk about the fact that you will end up with some stable distribution as you take these limits, rather than the special case we've proved, which assumes finite variance and says you end up with a Gaussian. But this is some bigger world of central limit theorems. There are also some lovely theorems that tell you how fast this convergence is, which matters a lot. Because obviously in applications, you care whether it takes two steps of averaging or a million before you get to it looks like a Gaussian. And then I think the notes talk about that. This is maybe one example of places where if people wanted to do a sort of statistically minded essay project, they would think about these types of theorems. That's the sort of thing you like. Okay. Tomorrow afternoon, let's stop for a minute, take a break, go to the toilet if you want. We'll come back and talk about the assignment, problem sets, whatever.
Not too bad.
Did you do a flip board?
No. Not the first part of it.
What's that?
Do you want to
do
good?
Yeah, so I think that we said
right,
you can go to A squared, you can go to A squared, you can go to A squared.